so that the human being fills up the gap with his evolved consciousness, which he calls the consciousness of the all presence. So these lines that are left as missing links, they are called nadis in Sanskrit, which are wrongly translated as nerves. They are not the nerves, but they are the lines of force along which the nerves are formed in the prenatal period. And there are some lines of force that are left without being filled, and they are called the nadis in the vertebral column. These nadis work as lines of consciousness in us, and under certain conditions, a line of consciousness makes its presence felt, and the moment it is present to us, we will feel the many things in creation. We will feel the many truths in creation without the necessity of the process of teaching and learning. Things will dawn to your mind just as there is light at the time of sunrise. So these strings in the veena symbolize the supramental consciousnesses working along the vertebral column inside. And all the devas that work with our intelligence and that work with the translating apparatus, those intelligences who translate our thoughts into our words and into our sentences and our utterances, those are called Vidyadharas. They work out the numbers and the shapes in us. And therefore, the process of the construction of the body in the mother's womb is called the construction of the temple. And the seven planes of our existence are understood and expressed as the square and the triangle, the lower four and the higher three. And this gave the idea of a building with a tower. It is irrespective of religions, because this is a pure science that exists in nature, which has nothing to do with religions. And the temple is symbolized as the abode of the living being, and the body with all its functions is compared to the temple at first. In Sanskrit, you have one mantra about the temple. The translation of that mantra goes in the following manner. Your body is the temple, and the living being in you, who is newly born, is the ancient one who was already living there. The one who was there before your birth is the same who is there after your birth in the temple of your body. Therefore, break the walls of ignorance and worship the omnipresent within the four walls of your constitution. This is one mantra given about the temple. And whenever we go to the temple, we are expected to utter this mantra and think, meditate upon the meaning of this. That this is the temple, and the indweller who is there from after my birth is the same as the one who was there even before my birth. That is the meaning. Therefore, let me break the walls of ignorance and meditate, I am that I am. In Sanskrit, I am that I am is called Soham. So means he, Ham means I am. So, soham means I am that. That is I am. Put together, I am that I am. The same thing you find in the Old Testament, in the book of Exodus, the same mantram heard by Moses on the mount. So this is called in Sanskrit the mantram of the temple. And about a few details regarding the ideas of the temple. Generally, in many cultures, the temple innermost part is constructed as having only one entrance. There are exceptions, no doubt, but universally it is accepted. But the sanctum sanctorum, the innermost part of the temple, should have only one passage, that is to enter and to come out. And inside you will find the installed God, the most sacred. Every religion has his own most sacred thing installed in the center. It may be the image, it may be the cross, it may be the word, it may be the symbol, or it may be the space that is understood as the content of the space. Because what exists there in your heart, in the form of the speaking I am in you, is nothing but the space in your heart. When you enter the space towards the right hand, the old space that is speaking through your body comes out, and the new space enters into your heart and begins to speak. This is what is explained in the science of the temple. What we call the indweller of the body is nothing but what we call space outside. Space created all the beings, so that space wanted to speak in the form of many beings to each other. And therefore, the temple of many ancient nations contains only one entrance and the same exit, without having a second entrance. This indicates the passage of air into the lungs and coming out in the form of exhalation. Inhalation of air and exhalation of air, taking the same passage through the nostrils or mouth, represent the outer God entering into the inner I am, making the inner I am live, or working as the inner I am, and then coming out as the outer air. So, we are speaking and praying about Him, but also we are speaking Him. That means, with the air we breathe in, we speak out our speech. What we call our speech contains only the air that we have borrowed from outside. So this is the borrowed robes. To remind us of this, the centralmost part of the temple has only one entrance and one exit. This is also understood as the Almighty or the All Existence preparing a temple of number 4, existing outside as the cosmic I am, entering inside as the vital I am, and working inside as the personal I am. Once again, the higher triangle, that is the three higher principles, working as the one who comes, who works inside, and who goes outside. we speak that we are living, but in fact the one who lives is always coming and going. That is why the pilgrims come and go into the temple. They create the presence of God in the temple, whereas the grass-minded people think that the God is there in the center of the temple. This is also one of the prayers about the temple in Sanskrit. That is, God is continuously entering into the temple and coming out of the temple in the form of pilgrims. This is one secret about the temple construction. And generally in many temples of India and also in ancient Chaldea, you find a lake before or behind the temple. That is to receive the reflection of the temple. When you sit on the bank of the lake, you will receive the total reflection of the temple in the water. And unless you sit down there and observe the reflection in the water, it is believed that your pilgrimage is not complete. That is because of the fact that you should understand that there is a reflecting principle also in you. The phenomenon of temple is reflected on the lower principles, so that the lower organs of the body are also constructed in the same fashion for the purpose of installing the God in the form of the Son to the Father. Installing the same God in the form of the Son by the Father with the help of the Mother. It is said to be the place of pilgrimage where the animals of wife and husband will be converted into the angels of father and mother. That is a sacred mantram about a temple. That is, before the fertilization of a child, they are husband and wife. But from the moment of the fertilization, they are no more wife and husband, they are father and mother. So it is said that the life is ennobled because their lower temple is consecrated to God. This is the reason of the ennobling aspect of the temple worship and the concept of keeping the sex life pure and pious is considered to be a part of the temple worship. So, in almost all the scriptures of the ancient nations, you will find the following ideas about the reflecting temple. One is the differentiation of the male and female bodies is for the worship of installing the image. That is for the multiplication of species in nature. Therefore, sex life should not be polluted. Purity of sex should be maintained so that pure bodies are produced to install the deity and keep him pure. So, what we call the sex life is called the reflection of the temple in water. And there are some nations which understood it in a different way also. There are nations that understood that the very concept of temple is a symbolism of sex. Those nations went into phallic worship and what we call the worship of ball and batches. Yes. And what is called the Venus worship. They went into sex and wine. And the nations went into degeneracy and decay. So there is the right understanding of the symbol of temple. There is the wrong understanding. To keep up the purity of the understanding of the temple, there are what we call the mystery temples and the secret societies. For example, the Society of Freemasonry and the ancient Egyptian ritual. But even among them, we have the genuine ones and the foul ones. In the name of Freemasonry, we see people gathering in halls, drinking deep like pigs, and dancing in the name of rituals. But at the same time, there are the pious temples and the pious societies existing. But many people do not know the existence of the real pious, because unless we are permitted, we are not informed of the existence of those societies. The societies which invite us to go into them in the form of esoteric societies and ritualistic societies, remember that they are all fake societies, because real wisdom never makes an advertisement of itself. It never invites you into its hall, just as the proprietor of a big restaurant invites you politely. Always, wisdom is there for you to seek. You are expected to go for wisdom. Wisdom never comes to your feet. So, the real societies are there existing through thousands of years. Even today, they are filled with the most pious men who want nothing for themselves except the wisdom. And only those people are admitted into those societies. The others cannot seek admission because they are not informed of the existence of such societies. So, among the temples, we have the noblest and the meanest concepts of the temple. We know the concept of temple in the form of phallic worship. That is, man worshipping the physical and astral woman, and woman worshipping the physical and astral man. It is called the left-handed magic by the ancient scientists of the temple. But even the highest secrets of temple, they indicate the male and the female worshipping each other, but not in the way which the emotional fellow knows. You know, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, he worshipped his wife because he used her as the temple and her body to install the most sacred concept of the temple, of the most sacred concept of the deity. That is something which generally people cannot understand. It is enough to remember that the seventh plane of consciousness in man and his wife are worshipped by each other. That is the Mahaparanirvanic plane consciousness. That is, the soul consciousness of man is essentially feminine by nature. The soul consciousness of a woman is essentially a male by nature. Not in the lower sense, not in the sense of the square, but in the sense of the triangle. So, the man is expected to worship the woman, and the woman is expected to worship the man above and beyond sex. So, this is expected to be practiced by husband and wife. And in the course of their practice, their sex life will be gradually eliminated. And the inspiration is purified from emotion, and a type of distillation of the consciousness takes place. And the pure male consciousness and the pure female consciousness are worshipped in each other. But this is something which is to be studied slowly. It is enough to remember that man in his innermost consciousness is feminine and woman in her innermost consciousness is masculine. Another aspect of the temple is, you know that the earth is revolving upon its own axis, producing day and night. And the four corners of the day, when seen from upon the earth, are considered as the base of the temple. The sunrise, noon, sunset, and midnight, they form the four corners of the earth in the mystic language of the initiates. When you stand at your place, when you mark the four timings, they are called the four corners of the temple. So the day is to be meditated as the base of the temple. It is called the temple of clay, that is the temple of the earth, the revolutions of the earth. You are expected to install God from the corner of the midnight, which is called north. The noon is called south for some astronomical purposes. Sunrise is called east, sunset is called west, noon is called south, and midnight is called north. And the Lord is said to enter from the north into the temple to the center. You see, this point of the day denotes zero time or midnight, and you are expected to be in sleep during that hour. And when you are sleeping, who is there existing? It is the Lord who is existing, who is looking after your heartbeat, your respiration. It is the omnipresent one. Therefore, he is expected to enter into you through your sleep. And that is the reason why in some ritualistic halls, you will find an officer in the east representing the Deva of sunrise, another officer in the west representing the Deva of sunset, another in the south representing the Deva of midheaven, and the northern chair is kept vacant. It is called the chair of the Lord or the chair of the master. So this is one of the concepts of temple. And there is another concept which is a little bigger than this. You see, the earth going round the sun, making the solar year, and the sun appears to go round the earth, which makes the solar year. If you stand on earth and observe the solar year, which is only a reflection of the earth's path around the sun, you will find four points. The one is called the vernal equinox, the day on which the night and the day are of equal duration, when you measure from the equator. That is called the beginning of Aries. That takes place on March 21st. And gradually from that date onwards, the duration of the day increases, the duration of night decreases. So that after 3 months, you will have one day with longest duration of the day and the shortest duration of the night. That is on 22nd June. Again, from that day, the duration of the day begins to decrease and gradually decreases until on September 21st, it becomes equal to night once again. And again, the duration of the night goes on increasing and the duration of the day decreasing until December 22nd, on which day there is the longest night and the shortest day. So these two are called the two solstices. These two are called the two equinoxes. So once again, you will find the same square and the cross within the circle, forming the base of the solar temple. It is called the temple of the astronomical god, or in our own words, it is the graphic representation of the solar year. Therefore, it is called the base for the temple of Solomon, because there were three nations having three groups of initiates in old days. All the three nations worked it out and they used to meet to confer initiations of the wisdom of this temple. The people of one nation had one word, Sol, as the name of sun god. And there are a second group of people having this as the name of sun god, An. And a third group of initiates who have Om as the name of sun god. All these three nations, the initiates gathered together and gave birth to a solar king who is called Solomon, whose temple is built in all the scriptures. This is the undercurrent history of the Solomon's temple. Now you see many Freemasons toiling very hard to build the temple. Many Freemasons struggling very hard to build this temple, but they have long lost the secrets, but not yet found. We hope that they find sometime in the future. From the time they begin to keep their temples pure and behave like human beings in their ritualistic temples, we hope so. This is one aspect of the temple. And in another language by the ancients, the square was called templa and circle is called quon. The present word contemplation comes from the concept of squaring up the circle. That is what we call contemplation. That means the four corners of the day and the four corners of the year, when meditated upon as the four petals of the same flower, the flower which forms the base of a temple, then you will understand what contemplation is. Because contemplation or meditation are the stages which cannot be achieved through trying very hard. It is by your behavior of the 24 hours and the way of your life during the year and the arrangement of your annual work, you will enter into a state called meditation and another stage called contemplation. But by trying hard, no one can succeed in entering into it. Many people ask, how to meditate? We should start it with our living, not with closing our eyes, But with opening our eyes and beginning to do our duty, fixing up the place and time of our work daily, keeping up the regularity of our routine, and the fidelity in our behavior, and the reliability in the mind of others. It is called the tongue of good report that is required. It is wrongly understood as others speaking good about us. See, the candidate will be questioned when he comes to enter into the temple. How do you hope to enter? The candidate is prompted to answer that he tries to enter with the help of the tongue of the good report. And the meaning is wrongly understood as others speaking good about us. No doubt, but that gives entrance to others, not to us. When others speak good of us, they are fit to enter the temple. That doesn't mean that we are fit. So, the original meaning of the tongue of good report is our tongue.